classes, we have discussed about the concepts and experiences, and after that we have discussed in detail the Edgar Dale's cone of experience, how best those experiences have been compiled on one another in the form of a cone, and what kind of experiences we find at the apex of the cone, and what kind of experiences we find in the base of the cone, and how those experiences can be utilized by teachers in the teaching learning process, and how that continuum has been created from abstractness to concreteness, from top to bottom of the cone, isn't it? And how best the Edgar Dale's cone of experience has been related with the Bruner's three important levels of learning, isn't it? And in continuation with that, a new step experiences learning model has been created. It has been created in 2012 by myself, first time, and I have presented these learning experiences in the form of a book. And the name of that book is itself Learning and Experiences. I hope you can view this book. Okay. It has been published by Lambert Publications of Germany. And in this book, a special chapter is dedicated to the experiences, or else you can say the step learning experiences model. Here you find that step learning experiences model. It looks like a step, isn't it? If normally you just see this model, it looks like steps. And you find 17 different experiences. Whereas in Edgar Dale's cone, you find 10 important experiences. He has listed out, isn't it? But here, 17 experiences, 7 more experiences I have added with the 10 experiences listed by Edgar Dale in his cone. The idea I got about framing a new model was probably in the year 2010 or 11, when I was teaching MED students in the classroom, the same Edgar Dale's cone of experience. I felt that Edgar Dale has listed these experiences in the year 1943, isn't it? When his first edition was released, 1943-44, or in that range, he has published that book and he has listed those experiences. Whereas almost 6 decades gone after that, and there are a lot of experiences which have been added to the learning arena, isn't it? And the very important aspect of computer has not been included in Edgar Dale's cone of experience. And nowadays, computer has become a part of our teaching and learning process. You cannot remove that element. And a lot of new technological approaches, methods have been evolved over a period of time. And those approaches, methods, devices, and the related experiences were not included in the Edgar Dale's model. So that made me to think and list out few more experiences where I could add all those experiences in a model and make it as a special entity, and so that I can present my views on the different experiences in a form of a specific model, and that is the model of step learning experiences model. Hope you are getting it. So this is the rationale behind in framing this learning and experiences model in continuation with the Edgar Dale's cone of experience. Okay. So we have also seen the special aspects of experiences in Edgar Dale's Konoff model as well. So in step experiences model also, we find at the base level, we find most of them are direct and purposeful experiences. As usual, whatever experiences we find in the Edgar Dale's cone, the same kind of direct and purposeful experiences we find in the step learning experiences model as well. And we expect that. We expect that when the first-hand experiences will be provided to the learner, they learn in a more permanent manner. So that's what we expect, isn't it? When all the sense organs are being used in the learning process, naturally the learning takes place at a mastery level, at a permanent level. Okay, that is the one aspect. And at the top of the step learning experiences model, here also you find verbal or textual experiences, as we found in the Edgar Dale's cone of experience, isn't it? And we also say that they are least effective, isn't it? Because when they are abstract, it is very difficult to understand, not so easy, because hardly very few sense organs we use in learning or in receiving that particular information. So that is the basic idea in framing this step learning experiences model. Here also at the apex, you find more abstract oriented experiences. When you come down, when you step down, you find a lot of direct and purposeful experiences. So that is a rationale in framing these experiences on one another. And here you find 17 different experiences. You find 17 experiences here. Let me read out those experiences from the apex. The first one is verbal, and followed by olfactory, gustatory, tactile, visual symbols, still pictures, radio, motion pictures, television and computers, exhibits, excursion, demonstration, dramatized experience, contrived experience, virtual experience, that is three-dimensional, four-dimensional aids or experiences, ubiquitous experiences, direct real experience, and direct and purposeful experience. So these are the 17 experiences I have listed out here. So these experiences can be chosen by the teachers. It is the responsibility of the teachers to choose the different experiences for their teaching process, for their students' learning process, by considering few aspects. What may be those aspects? It may be the content level of content, at what level of content there, and what is the difficulty of that particular content, and what is the level of students' understanding. That is another important component to be considered. Even the environment, how your teaching learning environment is conducive or supportive, so that you can use different kinds of experiences for your teaching learning process. Then the difficulty level of the content, as well as the objectives you want to achieve through your teaching process. So these may be some of the criteria which will really help a teacher in understanding the different conditions of the teaching as well as students' learning. In relation to that, teachers can wisely use or choose particular set of experiences or any one of the experience for the teaching purpose. So that is the rationale. Here, you find the list of experiences as well as what are the examples of those experiences. If you want to use it in the teaching process, how best you can make use, what you have to do. For example, verbal symbols. We have already discussed a lot in the previous classes when we have discussed about Edgar Dale's cone of experience. we say words, formulas, ideas, principles, concepts, philosophic aphorisms come under the verbal symbols, isn't it? Then olfactory experience, which is a new experience which I have added here. Olfactory, it is aroma of substance. It is knowing the thing with the help of smell, aroma. The third one is gustatory experience, which we receive the information through the tongue, through the sense of taste. Okay, that is gustatory experience. Fourth one is tactile or kinesthetic experience. Here, one has to handle or touch the materials to learn the things. It may be the surfaces, it may be the parts or kinds of objects which will be provided to the learners in the learning process. So that is learning by a sort of a learning by doing experience, handling the materials and learning. That is tactile or kinesthetic. Fifth one is visual symbols. We have already discussed this also. Visually, we just grasp the information, view the information, take the information with the help of our eyes, isn't it? It may be through still pictures, audio conference, or radio, tapes, CD, or mobile phones, isn't it? So, viewing is through sense organ, that is eye, and listening from the ears, that is radio and recordings. And the motion picture, the next experience is motion pictures, television, and computers. Here we require two sense organs, isn't it? To view, to watch, and listen, isn't it? And next one is exhibits. It's like an exhibition wherein display is being done on a particular topic, isn't it? It may be through educational fairs, and the exhibitions can also be find in museums, isn't it? And the next experience is excursions. We call it as field trips, educational excursions, isn't it? And visiting a historical place or a museum or any such place where we can get information in a live manner. And next experience is demonstration. Demonstrations for conducting experiments, especially in the science subjects, isn't it? If you are showing any models or if you are showing any graphs, globes or charts in the history subject also, we can conduct comes under demonstration. Next is dramatized experience. So where role playing and drama is being conducted, maybe inside the classroom with the help of teacher, or sometimes teacher can also be part of it. Okay. And next experience is contrived experience. It is nothing but simulated mode, as we do in the B.Ed. course, especially the micro teaching process is the best example of simulated mode, isn't it? And even simulated can be conducted with the help of models also, modeling models and mock-ups also. So that is a contrived experience. And the next experience is virtual experience. We call it as 3D, three-dimensional experience, isn't it? Maybe the 3D objects, 3D animations, video conferencing, smart boards, isn't it? Or the 3G mobile phones we use in the teaching learning process. That comes under the virtual experience, not in real. It's a virtual one. Then the four-dimensional, another dimension is being added here, because there is a lot of difference between 3D and 4D. Every time an extra combination of a new dimension is being added. Maybe if you visit a Ramoji Film City or the special theaters, wherein you find in the theaters, if you're watching a movie, means if raining in the movie, means you also get the rain effect in the theater. If some firework is going on in the movie, means you also feel that fire, the hotness of the fire in the theater. So what is happening here? An extra element of dimension is being added for the perception. So that is four-dimensional. Okay. Then ubiquitous experience, we have discussed a lot on that, isn't it? So here the learner is immersed with the learning situations, learning environment. Unconsciously, the learner is learning, isn't it? Learning. And even the learner is not conscious about what kind of facilities is being provided to him. So that is ubiquitousness, isn't it? And the direct real experience, this is a special kind of experience normally we find in understanding how digestion takes place in the human beings, isn't it? If you want to see the whole digestive process in the stomach, isn't it? So what do the camera can be inserted into the digestive organs, and we can see live how digestion takes place, what changes are happening in the digestive tracks. So normally outside of that digestive system we cannot see. Only mock-ups when we can be seen, or else the three-dimensional or computerized processes can be produced, isn't it? But not the real one. To see the real one, we have to go into the details of that particular systems. So that is direct real experience, a special kind of experience we get. And the last one is direct and purposeful experience. So which is purposeful as well as direct. That is the base of step learning experiences model. So the same thing we have seen in Edgar Dale's cone of experience also. So now we will see in detail one by one what kind of experiences we can this particular step learning experiences model. The very first one is verbal symbols. We have already discussed it, isn't it? There is no resemblance step learning experiences model. The very first one is verbal symbols. We have already discussed it, isn't it? There is no resemblance between the objects or the ideas and the appearances, isn't it? Whatever verbal words or the symbols we use, they are not at all related to the original objects. Example I had given, like a cow. If you utter a word cow, if you pronounce cow, cow is not at all related to the original cow. Neither it looks like that, neither it sounds like that, but still we have a common understanding that this is cow. So everyone have understood it, accepted it, and using it. That's all, isn't it? And we say that they are more abstract in nature. They are most abstract in nature. That is the very important thing. And normally, whatever sentences we use, the sounds we use, or the symbols we use, they all come under the verbal symbols. It may be a word, it may be an idea like beauty, it may be a concept like tragedy, or it may be a scientific principle like theory of relativity, or it may be a formula also like H2O, H2SO4, isn't it? Or a philosophical aphorism like honesty is the best policy, isn't it? These are considered as the verbal symbols because they are abstract in nature as well as they don't have any resemblance with the reality or the original concept. The next one is, okay, in continuation with that, actually, we say words are the verbal symbols of ideas. And many a times we think that the most intellectuals, we say most intellectuals use or know more words, isn't it? Many of the times we think that, isn't it? Most successful people, intelligent people have more vocabularies. It is not the vocabulary which made them the most successful and intelligent. It is their knowledge which made them more successful and intelligent. So always think that it is not just the vocabulary one possesses makes him or her an intelligent person, a successful person. It is just the knowledge which plays a very important role, isn't it? And naturally, knowledge is gained through words. Just most of the time. We read, isn't it? We listen. Getting it? So most of the time, we attend the lectures and learn many things. So naturally, the knowledge processing is helpful with the help of words. We call them as verbal symbols. And Dale said that, Dale has rightly mentioned it, that the pinnacle of the cone is not a rare field height frequented only by the great intellectuals, which means don't expect that only the great intellectuals can learn better with the help of verbal symbols. Even a small kid will also understand. A child will also read and write with the help of abstract words, isn't it? Verbal symbols. So which means, don't be a notion that only the intellectuals, only the easy learners, only the successful people know better the verbal symbols. So verbal symbols are required for every individual. So that's what Dale said. And even the newborn child starts learning, isn't it? When we utter a word in front of a key child, a newborn child, it starts receiving, it starts recognizing, it starts understanding, isn't it? Some symbols we make to the children, so they understand very well. So which means the verbal symbols are meant to communicate some ideas. They may be in abstract form, but communication happens very effectively too for the kids also. And when you want to create higher mental skills, the verbal symbols will help us in doing that. It's not that just only the abstract concepts will be described with the help of, or expressed with the help of verbal symbols. It is also very important to use for enhancing or for developing the higher mental skills of an individual. So which means the great scientists, poets, painters, engineers receive more information through verbal symbols. So verbal symbols are also very important aspects of learning process. So no need to criticize them. No need to criticize them. The next one is olfactory experience. This is a new experience which I have added in the step learning experiences model. What is that? It is also called as aroma experience. Sometimes we smell and identify. Sometimes we smell and think. Sometimes we smell and learn. So that experience is called olfactory experience. And normally this can be perceived by the olfactory sense or olfactory organ, that is nose. Isn't it? So there are receptive sensors in the nose which help us to sense the smell, which help us to receive the information through the smell. Okay? So that is the second important experience which we can have in the teaching learning process. And the substances of the smell may differ from substance to substance. Some are present in the solid form, some are present in the liquid form, and some are present in the gas form. Isn't it? And some cooking is going on, means easily we will smell and understand what food is being cooked. So the information you receive in the form of a gas, isn't it? And sometimes few substances are in a solid nature. They may also have a smell. For example, mango. We can smell the mango and say whether the mango is ripe or not. So it's in a solid form. And sometimes they are in liquid form also. So isn't it? So which means all the three varieties of substances may be having a different set of a smell. So through those substances, we receive the information, we smell and understand what object is that. What is that object? which we are smelling. Okay, and here easily one can distinguish the substances also based on the smell, isn't it? You can easily distinguish the substances, the materials, based on their smell, isn't it? Two different fruits you take means each fruit will be having a different set of a smell, isn't it? So like orange and mango, easily by smelling you can classify which is mango and which is orange. So which means we get the information which will also help us in classifying or distinguishing the elements of substances or a specific element also. Then the very important thing is the smell is also like a verbal symbol which don't have any resemblance with the subject, any resemblance with the material. Understanding it? Whatever we smell, directly it is not a replica of that actually. But we perceived it like that. We understood it like that. And we classify, we identify, that's all. But in real sense, it is not related with the any material. The smell is nowhere, it is connected and it is not related with the real object. Okay? Just it is a convention and just it is a understanding that if something is smells like that, it may be that object. Okay, so like verbal symbols, the olfactory experience also have no resemblance of the ideas. And Christopher Peacock, a researcher who has done a lot of research on sensation, he says that a smell may have no representational content of any sort. Though, of course, the sensation will be of a distinctive kind. It may be of distinctive kind, but it has got no representation with the real content or the real substance. In continuation with that, William Lycon, he says, olfactory experiences are representational. That's what I'm talking about. They are representational, that's all, isn't it? They give us little reason to think. Of course, when we smell, we think, isn't it? When we smell, we identify. When we smell, we start thinking, what may be the matter? What may be the subject, isn't it? But in reality, it is not representational, isn't it? And a smell is just a modification of our consciousness. Our consciousness will be slightly modified. Slightly we think towards that particular aroma. Okay. And there is a phenomenon of olfactory experience that it is not object rich as visual. It is not object rich as visual. Visual elements we can touch, we can see. But here we cannot. Isn't it? And whenever we will be in a different situation, we think more about such smells. If we are feeling hungry means, we easily identify knowledge of olfactory experience is not as object rich as visual experience. That's what I was discussing about. Because it differs from situation to situation. When we are hungry, we always feel to smell about foods. Isn't it? So which means always when a person is in a need, person is in a context, that favorable smells, that favorable experiences may be more stimulated. More stimulated. So that is the speciality of this section. And this olfactory experience leads us in the opposite direction from the visual case sometimes. Sometimes we go opposite also, isn't it? We smell something and we find something. We find something and we smell something. So that opposite direction also will be there sometimes. And olfactory experiences do not have the representational content is one aspect we have to understand from this experience. Second is the olfactory experience is not transparent also. It is not also not transparent. And third important thing is the nature of smell properties must be explained in terms of subjective reactions, which means it is very essential for a learner to know about it first, to know about it, then it will help him to understand it properly And sometimes when he or she smells about it, naturally one can identify the subject, identify the object. Otherwise, it is not possible. So making aware of the smell or aroma with the substance is very important. First time. When we understand it one time, naturally we can reproduce it, recall it, or identify it easily the second time or the consequent times. Isn't it? The first time learning is very important. Okay, that is the major aspect we have to understand from this experience. Then the third is gustatory experience. This is also a new experience which I have added in step learning experiences, which is nothing but learning or getting the information from the taste. Isn't it? That is, gustator is a Latin word. The gustatory has came from Latin word gustare, which gives a meaning to taste. Isn't it? Tasting. Tongue is also a very important sense organ to know few things, to understand few things, to learn few things. Isn't it? So we can make use that experience also for the learning purpose. So most of the tastes, what we have learned all in our life, is because of this experience. And it's a permanent experience also. Once you taste, means you will identify it, you will recall it, you can reproduce it number of times, and you guaranteely say, what is that substance? It may be a sour, it may be a sweet, it may be a salt, isn't it? So astringent, pungent, or chili, different tastes we had, isn't it? So all these tastes have been received or learned through the gustatory experience. Okay. And the different subjects of the taste is also differ. The different subjects means the objects, or else you can say the materials also. Materials of the taste in different size, in different shape, in different color. Isn't it? So everything is different from material to material, isn't it? Material to material. And it, as I told, it is one time learning process, or else you can say the permanent learning takes place once we experience. That's all. There is no need to experience again and again for concretizing the things, right? And students learn in a much, much better manner when they taste and learn, isn't it? Instead of teaching how acids are, what is the taste of acid, if you teach mere verbally, it will not fix them unless you give them a material to taste, isn't it? Or how citric acid is, what is the taste of a citric acid? The next experience is tactile kinesthetic experience. Here, the learner can have the idea or a concept by doing it with their hands. Hence, we call it as hands-on approach. They do it, they learn it by doing. That's what we say, learning by doing themselves. They use their hands, they use the movement in the learning process, physically involved in the learning process. So that experience is called tactile kinesthetic experience. And here, this approach will always help to absorb new information, because every learner's learning style differs. We know that. Some can learn better while seeing, some can learn better while listening, some can learn better while using their hands, isn't it? When they physically touch, when they physically handle and learn, they learn in a more concrete manner. So here, especially children and adults, when they will be given opportunity to touch and learn, to handle and learn, they learn in a more concrete manner. They learn in a more effective manner. That learned information will be there with them for a longer duration. So the concrete learning takes place with the help of kinesthetic or tactile experiences. We also call it as learning while playing, or playing by learning, something like that, isn't it? Sometimes they may use the model, sometimes they may use the diagrams, or a role-playing situation, isn't it? And sometimes students can move around in the classroom okay? And they can touch each other in the learning process, isn't it? They can use the flashcards, they can use the globe, they touch it, they rotate it, isn't it? So this is how, when we provide opportunities for the students to handle, to move, and to use physical movement in the classroom and learn, they learn in a better manner. So that experience is called tactile kinesthetic experience. And next one is visual experience. Visually what they see and learn, we have already discussed this experience in the Edgar Dale's cone of experience, isn't it? And here also, a picture or a shape that has a particular meaning or represents something or a process or an idea, which means any process or idea you would like to teach, you would like to introduce in the classroom, you can introduce it with the help of certain shapes, certain pictures, because they give certain meaning. They give a clear idea about the whole process, isn't it? For example, every visual experience has a particular set of instructions. A particular set of instructions. Because when we want to teach the process of cement, how cement produces, how cement will be produced in the industry. If you want to teach this, we can teach the same concept with the help of a flow diagram, with the help of an industry where the process is being taken place or carried out. What machines will be used, what materials will be used in that particular cement preparation process. If you just use the charts, the learners can learn it in a very better manner. We can compare the things also by showing charts or sometimes graphs, isn't it? If you just show two different graphs of two different years academic achievement, easily learners understands how the changes have taken place from one year to another year. Whether there is an enhancement of result, whether is a decrease of results, whether there is a stagnate of results, isn't it? So comparisons also being easily done with the help of graphs. And even maps would be very useful for a teacher in disseminating the different concepts like countries. Countries, their shape, isn't it? Their geographical area and the different aspects of geography, isn't it? History, geography, even science elements can easily taught with the help of the visual symbols. Okay? And even the language is itself a visual symbol because we use the letters. Letters are the form of visual symbols like A, B, C, D. They are just visual symbols, isn't it? Based on those symbols, we learn, we transact language also, isn't it? So this is the visual symbols. And John Dewey has rightly said that deposit of an idea through the experience. So whenever some experiences are being utilized in the learning process, there must be deposit of an idea. Means one should deposit some kind of idea in the mind. So that should be the motto of every experience. And here, when we use different charts, tables, diagrams, and graphs, naturally some kind of depositing the information with the individual is possible. Okay. And even it progresses over a period of time, isn't it? And even how progress has been taken place over a period of time can easily described, explained with the help of charts and maps. Is it? That is also possible. Not only that, the teacher can focus the attention of the whole class if the teacher is using charts, maps, and graphs in the classroom. It is like a attention grabber, isn't it? It grabs the attention very easily. And not only that, the teacher can illustrate the information in a better manner. So the clear illustration can be possible with the help of visual symbols. And that is the reason we use books and printed materials in the classrooms or in the teaching learning process. And there is a big aspect of visual symbol is non-verbal communication patterns also. We use body language. We call it as posture, isn't it? Even the facial expression, eye contact, they all come under the visual symbols. Based on just the facial expression, students understand very clearly teacher is in what mood. What is the mood of the teacher, isn't it? So like that, they are all also the visual symbols, not just the letters, not just the formulas. Even the non-verbal communication patterns, elements can also be called as visual symbols. The next experience is still pictures, radio recordings. Still pictures, yes, again it is borrowed from the Edgar Dale's cone of experience. We call them as one-dimensional aids. It may be a recording, it may be a radio, or it may be a still picture. In still picture, we use only one sense organ. In radio also, we use only one sense organ. In recordings also, we use only one sense organ. So hence, we call it as one-dimensional aids. Here, the learning happens through seeing or hearing. Okay, any one of the sense organ we use here. And the examples for those one-dimensional aids are film strips, visual projectors, projectors like slide, overhead projectors, tripods, glass slide, and photographs, radio, tape recorder, or recordings. They all come under one-dimensional aids. And here, the pupils, sometimes they may be mere spectator. They act like a spectator if we are showing them still pictures, maybe in the dark room, isn't it? So the dark room removes the distraction. So pupil will be very focused on the still pictures, isn't it? So naturally, that still picture with the environment will attract the attention of the learner. They make the learner to learn the things very effectively because distraction is removed. Okay, and focus is expected on the content, on the subject, isn't it? Even the radio and recordings, they also help us. While listening the radio, the learner can focus on listening capacity, isn't it? On listening. When they listen, they learn more. So the outer, all elements of distraction can be removed very easily. That concentration aspect will be improved over a period of time when we listen carefully, when we start listening radio programs and recordings. And the best thing of recordings is we can use it whenever we want. We can repeat it number of times, as many as we can, isn't it? So we can reuse it, relearn it, and we can modify our learning patterns and modify our behaviors. So this is the specialty of still pictures, radio and recordings. And film strips and slides, they also come under the motion pictures. They are low cost materials. The cost is also very low, as well as versatile. You can bring variety into the classroom because locally they can be prepared by the teachers. Nowadays, anything can be recorded. Any slides can be produced very easily, isn't it? By using the available resources. So which makes a learner to feel that whatever information a teacher has brought into the classroom, brought into the content, is available in the locale. He or she is very familiar with the content, isn't it? So this is the specialty of film strips and slides. And even slides can be considered the PowerPoint presentations also, what we bring into the classroom nowadays, isn't it? So they are made or prepared by the teachers themselves. And even the tapes here, the exhibition can be done with the help of those tapes, or those can be exhibited or shown to the students, isn't it? And if somebody is very hesitant in talking in the classroom, they can talk behind the scene here. They can be recorded, they can be shown also. Like that, whatever platforms we are using nowadays through online, those who are very hesitant in their classrooms, in asking the questions, in participating in the debates or the discussion, now starting debating, now starting asking the questions very freely. It's because of their hesitant nature, or you can say the withdrawal syndrome. They withdraw in the real situations. When they feel that it is behind screen or from the away from the group, definitely they come forward and participate very freely. So that aspect is also possible in the film strips and in the slides also, as well as in the tapes and recordings, isn't it? And mobile phones are very easily being used nowadays for the audio conferencing, isn't it? Because audio conferencing is one-dimensional. Okay, if you use video, it will be a two-dimensional. So we are talking about one-dimensional aid. So mobile phones can be used very effectively for audio conferencing as well as solving the problems of the students. Students feel free to ask the questions, and the audio conferencing can be used very effectively for counseling and guidance also. Teacher can make use these experiences for guidance and counseling approaches also. Okay. And the next one is motion pictures, television, and computers. It's a set of experience. I've compiled all those three. So earlier in the digital days, computers were not added because computers were not developed so much and not utilized also very rampant at that time. But now computer has become a part of it, and I thought to add with the television and motion pictures because they are two-dimensional aids, isn't it? So when we use the motion pictures, naturally we can stop whenever we want, isn't it? And we can solve the doubts of the students. And again, we can restart the picture. That is the speciality of that. And when we think that actually a real event is not possible to show, yes, these experiences are very useful for us. When we can't take our children to the real experience, of course, we can show the television programs, motion pictures, isn't it? To show them what has been happened. What has been happened. And even the historical events, which are in the past nature, we cannot make them again in a new situation, isn't it? We cannot create them also. So such situations, such past eras can be easily bring into the classrooms with the help of motion pictures, televisions, isn't it? Even with the help of computers also, by creating those programs. And we can make our children to feel or to give a direct experience in the classroom. That is the speciality of motion pictures and television. And nowadays, a lot of television programs are being prepared, developed, and being utilized in the classrooms, isn't it? Right from elementary to postgraduate level, almost all programs you find curriculum-based as well. Supportive programs are also there. Most of the programs are being developed by NCIT for schools and plus two level, and the MHRD for higher education sector. And computers. Computer has become a very vital tool in the teaching learning process. We cannot even think beyond computers. We cannot think without computers, how to teach, how to learn, isn't it? So it has become a part and parcel of life. Naturally, it became part and parcel of teaching also, isn't it? Because it is not only compact, it is extremely powerful, versatile, and can be accessible very easily, can be used very easily by anybody in the world. So such a important device we got in the form of computer. And some of the science concepts which can be very easily explained and very quickly explained with the help of computer-generated graphics, isn't it? So naturally, the science concepts can be very easily disseminated among the learners with the help of computer or computer generated graphics, videos, or any of the content, you can say. And computer assisted instruction is very helpful for us nowadays for giving the laboratory experiences to the students. Instead of taking the students to the real lab, we can have the computer generated laboratories, or else you can say the e-laboratories, which can be very used, very usefully make use in the classrooms, isn't it? With the help of the traditional setting of classrooms also, we can make use the computers as a complementary device, as a supplementary device, isn't it, in the teaching learning process. And one-to-one interaction is possible through the computers. And even you can give the responses in a very spontaneous or instantaneous way. If students are asking the questions, means instantly you can answer all those questions, isn't it? So that learners can learn according to their own pace. Learners can solve the doubts at the very moment when they come across, and they can move further in the learning process. So that is also a very important aspect of computer. And computer technology normally derives a capacity to present educational, a powerful medium, which has made our education system a more powerful medium. And very dynamically, we can present the content in the different forms, isn't it? Especially in the science and mathematics subjects. And even we can make use of these computers in all subjects, irrespective of subjects we can use. It depends on the teacher, how best he or she make use of the computer applications in the teaching learning process. But naturally and most powerfully, the computers are being utilized in mathematics and science subjects. Okay, so that is computers. And next is exhibits. It is exhibition of materials, maybe the series of photographs or models or charts, isn't it? And sometimes the exhibition includes demonstration of experiments also, or a demonstration of events also, demonstration of materials also. So a lot of things can be demonstrated or exhibited in different situations. Here, the student can participate in two forms. He can participate as a spectator. If somebody is exhibiting, or someone is exhibiting something, means he can participate as a spectator. He just views what all the things have been exhibited. The second thing, if somebody is giving them an opportunity to manipulate or handle, that would be a great thing for a learner, because he can handle the things and learn. Okay, so always the opportunity for handling the materials in the learning process or in the exhibitions will definitely count a lot in the learning to a greater extent from learner point of view. Okay, that concretization takes place in the learning process. So that is exhibits. The next one is field trips. We call it as educational excursion. If somebody wants to take first-hand experience by visiting that particular place, it may be a museum, it may be a factory or a geographical area, or an environment of plants and animals, that is called field trip, is it? Where the real learning takes place, because the learner can see and note down two important things he can do in that particular place, isn't it? One can watch it lively and note down the things. So the learning takes place to a greater extent because of this process, isn't it? And sometimes the students will be given opportunity to discuss also. First they see or observe, they note down, then if discussion will be provided, definitely the students' learning would be at a greater height or a greater level, as we can say. And hence, when observation is combined with participation, field trips becomes more meaningful. That's what the words of Edgar Dale. In his third book, he has written that. And naturally, the students of geology, biology, history, is it these field trips will be like a boon for them. Next is demonstrations, demos. We can demonstrate in the classroom how things are or how things are to be done, isn't it? So students can see it and learn it. Naturally, the demonstration process takes place most of the time in the classroom. In different subjects, isn't it? And students will be the spectators, because demonstrator is naturally a teacher, and sometimes teacher can use the students' help also in the demonstration process, so that a few of them can come and render their services to the teachers also in the demonstrating the events. They could also learn in a very better manner. Okay, the participation leads to enhancement of learning process. And we can explain very easily through the help of demonstration. It may be different processes, or it may be different activities, isn't it? Or it may be different products which can be demonstrated and shown in the classroom. How things happen, how things will be, how things performs in the particular process. Okay, and the two things very important here: when the demonstrated materials are very costly, or practical materials are very costly, the demonstration is very good for the teacher to use in the classroom. That's one thing. Second thing, when experiencing physical harm in the learning process, some acids are there, titrations are being done in the classroom, and they may be very harmful if students touch them, if students may use them with their hand. In such situations, it is always better to use demonstrations. Okay, so that a teacher very carefully handles the materials and show the students that how things can be done. Okay, that's the one thing. Second thing, if they are very costly, there may be a chance of falling down and breakage, isn't it? In such situations also, teacher can handle those materials very carefully and demonstrate the things. So wastages can be reduced with the help of demonstrations. Harmfulness can be eliminated in the learning process, isn't it? So by considering these aspects, we feel demonstration experiences are very vital in the learning process. And the next one is dramatization. Using drama, mime, role playing, isn't it? Quizzes and many more techniques of dramatization in the teaching learning process. Possibly, sometimes we cannot use all the live examples. We cannot bring all the live examples to the classrooms. So in such situations, we can make use of our teaching experiences in the contrived experiences. Contrived means simulated one experiences, isn't it? Where a teacher can play a role and student can play a different role, isn't it? By playing different roles in that particular setup, the concept can be easily explained. The concept can be easily described to the audience, so that they can presume, they can learn, they can assume the responsibilities, isn't it? So that is called the dramatization. Okay, here, getting close to the reality as possible we can. So that is the special thing, isn't it? So sometimes we cannot take our children to the real classrooms. So what happens in the classroom setup only? One will play as a role of a teacher, the other will play the role of a student. So like that. And some situation will be created and a concept will be developed. How things happen in the classroom, isn't it? Or how parliament works. The best example I can tell you, isn't it? How parliament works. How parliamentary affairs takes place in the parliament, isn't it? So that can be easily shown with the help of selecting few students as behaving the parliamentarians, isn't it? So one is the chair of that particular session, isn't it? So like that, different aspects can be shown, and we can bring our children into the realities, okay? Taking them to the as close as possible into the realities. And the very important thing of dramatization is it will help the children's in development of five general areas. Always when you use drama in the classroom, they will be benefited in five areas. What are those areas? Those areas are physical development or kinesthetic skills, artistic development or drama and theater skills, mental development or thinking skills, personal development or intrapersonal skills, and the fifth one is social development or interpersonal skills. These skills can be easily developed among children if we use dramatization as an experience in the classroom. And a lot of research have been conducted in drama, and they said that performing art is a kind of a drama which help all the learners or all the participants for self-expression. They can express their self, they can express very freely. So the self-expression is itself a way of learning. We always expect in our children that they should express more and more in the learning process. So drama will help us in doing that. And drama is also very helpful in the learning process because it involves students' intellectual ability, physical ability, social ability, emotional ability. All these abilities will be utilized, and not only that, these abilities can be enhanced also. The enhancement or development of these abilities is also possible in dramatization, and naturally students will develop critical thinking skills through drama. So that is the potential of an individual, isn't it? An individual can think to a greater extent. That is critical thinking. So critically thinking ability can be enhanced if we use more dramatization approaches to the teaching learning process. So that is dramatization. And there are two forms of activities will be performed in drama. One is watching drama, other is participating in drama. As I already mentioned that, isn't it? Watching will be less participation, as I can say. But when one participates in the drama, the learning happens to a greater extent. The learning happens to a greater extent. So hence, schools and colleges should use dramatization as an important approach for the teaching learning process. It helps in fullest extent of development of all the areas of Howard Gardner. You can remember him because of his multiple intelligences theory, isn't it? So he himself told that the vision for schools which use multiple intelligences to incorporate authentic learning, which means when you expect that all multiple intelligences must be enhanced or developed, means if you develop, means that is called authentic learning. Always schools and colleges must strive hard for learners' authentic learning, students' authentic learning. And he says when authentic learning happens, it is through dramatization, because all possibilities of competencies can be developed through drama, because it is not just emotional. The students use their physical, emotional, intellectual, psychological, all these aspects, all these competencies come into the picture in dramatization. So hence, drama, music, so such or theatrical activities will definitely help in authentic learning. So that is the speciality of dramatization. And the next experience is contrived experiences. We also call it as artificial experience. It is the next level experience. And the contrived experiences is nothing but editing of reality experience. isn't it? So we edit the reality and we show it in a contrived form. We show it in a artificial form, maybe a working model. The reality we when we cannot show means we can show the working model to the learners. It may be smaller in the size, isn't it? It may be simpler in its process. When the real one is more complex one, we can make it in a more simple one and edit it and show it to the students in the learning process, isn't it? And learner believes that he is in the real live or life experience sometimes, isn't it? So reality can be brought into the classroom with the help of contrived experiences because it overcomes the limitations of space and time. So those limitations can be easily overcome with the help of contrived experiences. The best examples are the models and mockups. Few models and mockups we use, no? They can be scaled down, they can be used in a variety manner, isn't it? They can be described layer by layer in a more comprehensive manner, isn't it? And even parts can be shown very easily, described very effectively. So such models, mockups, and we can also call them as cutaways also. Cutaways, we can dissect them and show them very easily, isn't it? And every section or every part of the model can be shown very easily. So such models, mockups, cutaways are the best examples of artificial experience or contrived experiences. Why do we make use of these experiences? We use them because of four important valid reasons. The first reason is they overcome the limitations of space and time. Second one is they edit reality for us to be able to focus on the parts, to be able to focus on the processes of a system that we intended to study. Isn't it? Whatever may be the intention of our study, we can study very easily by considering only that part. So that is the second important reason we use it. The third important reason is overcoming the difficulties of the size. Sometimes the real one is very big. We cannot go to that place to see it either, or we can bring that material to the classroom. So in such cases, contrived experiences are very useful. And the fourth one is we can understand very easily all the processes, concepts, isn't it? So because of these four reasons, we make use contrived experiences in the classroom. And the next experience is virtual learning experience, virtuality, isn't it? Nowadays, we are talking more about the virtual classrooms, so virtual libraries, and the whole world has become virtual, isn't it? Virtual books we have, virtual libraries we have, virtual laboratories we have, isn't it?
Virtual advertisements.
Yes. So a lot of virtuality has come into the picture of everyone's life now, isn't it? And it is the next stage of contrived experience, I can say. See, contrived experiences are, see, virtual can also be contrived, no issues at all, but it changes in its effect. So virtual experiences effects are much more better and effective than the contrived experiences, isn't it? And students or the learners feel joy or feel very joyful in the learning process, and even the level of understanding differs. So the high level of understanding can be possible with the use of virtual experiences. And the virtual experience involves a set of teaching and learning tools. Tools may be softwares nowadays, isn't it? Learning and teaching tools, which are specially designed to enhance a student's learning experience. Here, the intention of that particular experience is to enhance the learning experience of the learner by including the computers and internet in the learning process. So this is what virtual learning is all about. And the virtual learning environment has got a range of substances, range of materials, from starting text-based inferences, interfaces, to the most complex 3D graphical output. So normal text to the animations, three-dimensional animations, three-dimensional graphical outputs. So that is a range, isn't it? And they are representational as well as motivational. They exactly look like that. They exactly, the nature of that particular substance can be understood in a three-dimensional way, as well as they motivate the learner in the learning process. And always the three-dimensional images, they are more interactive to the users. They feel that they are in the real life situation. They are watching the live one, isn't it? That is what we call virtual reality. It presumes the learner, or the learner assumes that he is watching the live one, the real one. Hence we call it as virtual reality. So what is virtual reality? Virtual reality is electronic simulations of environments, electronically simulated one. So that kind of environment, the environment will experience, or which we experience with the help of head-mounted eye goggles. So eye goggles are there nowadays, isn't it? So those goggles can be used, head-mounted eye goggles, to experience that environment. And sometimes wired clothing, even cloths can also be veiled. Through that also we can experience, enabling the end user to interact in the realistic three-dimensional situations. So one can interact very easily in the 3D simulation mode, in a 3D situations. So that is what is called virtual reality. Okay. So the virtual reality and augmented reality, all these concepts we have already discussed in the classroom, isn't it? So those experiences come under contrived experiences. Okay. And next is the virtual classroom, which is also part of contrived one. Isn't it? What we're experiencing now, the Google classrooms, virtual classrooms, Zoom classrooms, all these classrooms are part of virtual reality. They are web-based. You can access the content here. Grades can also be given. Assessment can also be done very easily by using the different classroom tools, isn't it? It's a powerful medium of interaction where video conferencing can be done, PowerPoint presentations can be done, chatting can be done, isn't it? And also we can discuss and resolve the issues, isn't it? So these are all the important aspects of virtual reality. And the next one is four-dimensional experience. 4D. An extra element is added to the 3D now, which means in most of the special venues like amusement parks or Ramoji Film City like places, wherein you find an extra element in your experience, isn't it? As I rightly mentioned that they will show you a movie. They will show you a movie. Specifically designed theaters are there. Nowadays, you find these theaters in Thailand, Mexico, Hong Kong, Nepal, South Korea, United States, and India also. In India also, you find few theaters where if you go and watch the movies, means one thing, two sense organs you can use there. One is just viewing and listening. Eye and ear you can use for experiencing that film. And the extra element they add is, if you think that a song is going on, a song is going on in a rose garden, means you can smell the roses also in the theater. This is an extra element added to the theater. Think that a song is running and the song is in the rain. You feel the water sprinkles in the theater. Or else, think that hero is fighting in the climax scene and everywhere there is a fire. In the film I'm saying, in that moment, you feel that heat in the theater also. So what's happening here? An extra dimension is being added. Most of you have seen the 3D films. If somebody will leave the arrow, means the arrow will come towards you only directly. Isn't it? Use those goggles. So that is a three-dimensional effect. So like that, some four-dimensional, five-dimensional effects are being added, means you feel something like that. Or else you may feel like hero is or heroine is in the lift. Think that a scene is there, hero or heroine is in the lift and they are coming down. They are coming down to the ground floor. The audience will also feel that they are also coming down. So that kind of feel is being added in theaters. Understanding now, what is that 4D effect? Okay, so these effects will be definitely added in the future. So these effects will be part of every theater in future, probably. Slowly the number is increasing. You might have come across Avatar movie. Avatar movie, probably 10 years back it came, it seems. So if you watch it, if you could have watched it in the theater, you could have experienced it. Is it what is 3D, 4D experiences are? Okay, so these experiences can also be used in the teaching learning process in future. We don't know. Every school and every university may be having such like kind of theaters and where the space related experiences, isn't it? Or deep sea related experiences can be experienced very easily by the learners. Or teacher can make use such experiences for student learning. So like that, this is all come under the four dimensional experiences. And next is ubiquitous learning experience. We have discussed a lot of things regarding this, isn't it? Ubiquitous is itself a pervasive one, omnipresent and ever present, and everywhere it is present. Okay, so that learning experiences is any setting of the environment in which students can become totally immersed in the learning process. They may not be very conscious in the learning process, but they are immersed in the learning process without noticing even, without noticing it that they are learning or somebody is helping. So that kind of environment is called the ubiquitous learning environment, isn't it? Because a lot of digital information is being transferred nowadays. We can store, we can transfer, we can communicate by using digital technologies nowadays. As we have started from e-learning to mobile learning, then ubiquitous learning, isn't it? So learning is itself pervasive now. So assimilation of all that computing aspects, ubiquitous computing aspect into the teaching learning process, into the education setup has made us to perceive, had made us to experience the ubiquitous learning experiences in the learning pattern. Okay. So it's a kind of experience where learning is happening all around the student, but the student may not even be conscious of the learning process. So that is what ubiquitous learning is all about. And here, the pervasive computing environment commonly or mainly concluded in the following, like user mobility, resource and location discovery, content awareness, which may be from user point of view, which may be from time or location point of view. That's a context awareness. Then collaborative interactions we can expect in such kind of learning platforms, ambient information, calm technology, event notification, adaptive interfaces, invisibility, object augmentation, and anytime and from anywhere. So this aspect, if we include in the learning process, that is called ubiquitous learning. Getting it? So this experience is also most advanced one. And the 14th experience is fifth, 16th experience is direct real experience, which I've already described to you in a very brief manner. that if something we would like to understand from human digestive system, in a real sense, I'm telling you, what we can do, we can send a small micro camera into the digestive tract and we can record the events, what is happening in a live manner. It is also an experience. And sometimes even the depth of the earth, depth of the sea, what happens? We can't see the live events. So in such situations, we can send the technological gadgets, cameras, into those places and we can watch the live scenes. So such experiences are called direct real experiences, where a pupil get an opportunity to observe and study directly. Okay, so hence I have given these experiences as name direct real experiences, which may be having high impact on the learning, isn't it? The learning impact would be definitely high, and there is no alternative for it. There is no alternative for it. You cannot provide any alternative experience for it, isn't it? So like that, these experiences are very unique experiences. And the last one is direct purposeful experience. As we find these experiences in the cone, the same experiences we find in the step learning experiences model as well, because they are the real experiences. All the sense organs are being used in the learning process. We see, we handle, we taste, we feel, we touch, and we smell. And they are all purposeful experiences. So such experiences are rich experiences of life. So whatever experiences we get in most of the time in the lifetime, isn't it? In the life juncture, we get such experiences. Hence, they are most useful, most productive experiences. And the best examples are even the tying knot. Whenever we tie it, then only we understand how to put a knot to a tie, isn't it? Even preparing a meal, cooking is the best example. So watching the video is something different, but when you cook yourself, isn't it? You learn much better, isn't it? So riding a bicycle, driving a car are the best examples of direct purposeful experiences, which are more related with the life, which are more related with the live learning, lively we learn. Okay, and what we can conclude out of these experiences is different concepts demand different experiences, isn't it? Science concept expect different experiences, social science concepts expect different experiences, language aspects expect different experiences. So which means you cannot use all the experiences for all the concepts. That's very important. Teachers must understand that all type of concepts cannot be learned with the same kind of experiences. Isn't it? One thing is you cannot use all the experiences for all the concepts. And second thing is all concepts cannot be learned through same kind of experiences. So which means every concept demands different kinds of experiences. For example, if you want to study the parts of an animal cell, think that you are a teacher and you are teaching the parts of animal cell in the classroom. What best you can do, or what experiences you can use? You can use, yes, you can bring a microscope into the classroom and you can directly display that cell to the students. One thing. Second thing, you can use a chart of a microorganism and show that these are the cells of an animal. Second thing, and naturally we say the direct observation is much more better than the chart or the visual symbol, right? One thing. The same kind of experience can be given in a richer form with the help of virtual experiences, like three-dimensional animated experience also you can use, isn't it? So which means when we use three-dimensional experiences, which are more effective than the visual experiences and verbal experiences. Verbally we can explain also, that is also an experience, isn't it? So, for example, physics. If you're teaching any concept in the physics means, example you take like a piston movement. How the piston moves, what is the movement of a piston? You can show with the help of a 3D animation, isn't it? Or else you can show the piston movement with the help of a diagram also. So always 3D animation is much more better than the diagram, isn't it? So like that, there are number of subjects wherein teachers can make use of the different experiences to make their students to understand the concepts clearly. Okay, so which means there are a lot of subjects which expect different sets of experiences. There are a lot of different types of learners in the classroom. They also expect different kinds of experiences. And there are a lot of teachers, they are well versed with the different experiences of teaching. They also need different set of experiences, which means it depends on a lot of things. So before concluding, these two aspects are very important for teachers. The teachers must understand the two types of characteristics of objects. What are those? One is overt characteristic and the other is covert characteristic. Every object will be having a set of characteristic. Overt means we can see, we can touch. Or the characteristics of external in nature. External characters are called overt characteristics. There where we can touch and sense visually. But covert characteristics are internal characteristics. We cannot touch, we cannot sense visually. Inside characteristics, isn't it? So these two characteristics are very important for every object. Unless a teacher understands what kind of characteristics he or she wants to describe, he or she wants to explain to the students, they will not understand what kind of experiences they have to give. Understanding it? So mathematics, you take the example of mathematics subject. They are mathematics subject concepts are more in abstract manner. It is not possible to give direct experiences for mathematics. We cannot. Most of the concept, isn't it? So what we have to do? We have to use contrived. We have to use abstract one. Isn't it? The verbal and visual experiences are more useful. In a similar manner, language learning is also possible from visual and verbal experiences. Direct experience you can't give. Getting it? So every subject and historical events are the past events. You cannot go back and show the real events to the students. What you can do? So the best experiences would be contrived experiences, three-dimensional experiences. Creating a video and showing them. They learn better. So understanding it, which means each subject is unique. Unique in terms of its characteristics, its concepts, its content. So based on the content, the teacher has to understand what experiences would be ideal to be chosen for the teaching process so that the learners can learn in a better manner. And we have two sets of education, two components of education technology, hardware and software. We know that, isn't it? Nowadays, we are using more hardwares and softwares in the teaching learning process, isn't it? And most of the experiences are software related experiences nowadays. Getting it? We are shifting more towards software related. Earlier, we were more oriented towards hardware. We used to carry globe, we used to carry charts, we used to carry notebooks, graphs to the classroom. Nowadays, we won't bring hard materials to the classroom. We use more and more soft materials, more and more virtual concepts. virtual items or ubiquitous kind of experiences in the classroom. And more importantly, the impact of software is always greater than the hardware. Research is proving that softwares are doing great job in the students' learning processes. So hence, wherever, whenever it is possible to use the contrived and software-related experiences, we can make use in the teaching learning process so that we can expect the whole education system would be the virtual one in future. Tomorrow, you can expect all the virtual kind of atmospheres. There will be virtual universities, there will be virtual teaching, virtual laboratories, virtual libraries, virtual examination, and virtual certification. Getting it? So that aspect will be there in near future. So it is the teachers, we have to change our thinking, change our teaching methodologies so that we can orient towards that and use the suitable experiences for our teaching processes. And even at the teacher training level, all the students must be trained in all these experiences, at least, isn't it? So that they can come across the different levels of experiences, different kinds of experiences, so they can make use in their practice teaching, as well as when they become the real teachers, they must be ready to use all these experiences. And another important thing is all in-service teachers must also be trained these experiences, learning experiences, so that they can be well-versed in the learning experiences and they can use it in the real classrooms. Okay. And the last concept to conclude my presentation is, which has been given by Edgar Dale himself. He says, which experience is more effective than the other? Which means, never classify, never compare the different experiences. That's what he told, isn't it? He never, most of the educationists or the practitioners say that Edgar Dale has said that one experience is good than the other or more effective than the other. No, Dale never told that. Dale just gave 10 different experiences. So in that context, I also agree. I am also not saying with the help of this self-learning experiences that one experience is good over the other. Every experience is unique. Every experience is good. But what extent we use, to what level we use, for what cause we use, for what kind of students we use is important. Okay. All the great learners also use abstract experiences. All the slow learners will also use direct and live experiences. Children will also use direct experiences. Children will also use abstract experiences. Getting it? So based on the availability, based on the need, nature of content, we can choose the different set of experience for the usability in the teaching learning process.